When I was younger, like any kid, I had the things I loved. Films, toys, teddies, TV shows. But one TV show that has stuck with me since then has been Doctor Who. I first got into Doctor Who when I was 3 years old. At my godmother's house, her son, ironically, had a blue box of Doctor Who figures, and we'd play with them for hours while watching a rerun of Eccleston's Dalek. I can still remember the 4-year-old me in the corner of the sofa watching the Man with a Box fight off the Daleks in the Asylum of the Daleks, with Matt Smith as the Doctor. My Doctor. By then, Doctor had re-established itself as an icon of British TV, and this was made clear with the opening of the Doctor Who Experience, which I actually visited myself after the 2012 Christmas special. I've attended Comic Cons, I've went to the 2015 Symphonic Spectacular, and today, after a decline in viewership, things are looking promising now that Russell T Davies has returned as the showrunner. And to celebrate the 60th anniversary of my beloved show, here is a one-of-a-kind Doctor Who review. So we're going to start this off with the Doctor. Now, the Doctor is the Doctor. The Doctor is a Time Lord from the planet Gallifrey, and I'm not going to bother like spending time going over stuff. So, and I am probably going to explain my favorite moment of every Doctor. Now we're going to start off with the first Doctor. I'm just going to straight up put him in iconic because he's the first Doctor all the way back in 1963, William Hartnell. Just basically, without William Hartnell, we would not have Doctor Who. Without Sidney Newman, Verity Lambert, and William Hartnell as the Doctor, it could have been a whole different thing. My favorite scene of William Hartnell is probably, it's a scene from, ironically, it's a scene from the Celestial Toymaker episode, where he sort of tricks, spoiler alert, he sort of, he just roll the clip. Yeah, I just think it was brilliantly executed, basically. Anyway, second Doctor. I like him. I like Patrick Troughton. Is things are missing from the BBC archive. We do have the animations, but they're not as like. What I'm basically trying to say is, animations aren't the actual actors in a way because the actual actors like, yeah, sure their moves are animated, but it's not. I'm not sure if it's exactly what they were doing. I still like him, Cosmic Hobo, as he's called. I'd probably put him in amazing. Because he is amazing. In terms of favourite scene for Patrick Troughton, I don't know, because I've got a DVD of him, and all the old Doctor Who's now on iPlayer, so I'm trying to play catch up. He makes a joke about something having a complete mental breakdown.
Are they safe now?
Oh, yes, quite safe now. The power cable generated an electrical field and confused their tiny metal minds. You might almost say they've had a complete metal breakdown.
Oh,
I'm so sorry.
Okay.
Now we've got John Pertwee, the third Doctor. This is the Doctor that my grandpa remembers watching. I liked the third Doctor. It was sort of, I don't know, he just seemed like a bit of, like, a character that knows what he's doing, in a way. You know what I mean? He also had the car, Bessie. I'd probably put him in Amazing as well. Most of them are probably going to end up going in Amazing. My earliest memory of John Pertwee's era, it was Death to the Daleks, I think it was called. They were on a planet, and, like, technology wasn't working right. That's the earliest memory I have. I remember watching them get exterminated.
The Earth creatures are to be exterminated. Fire at my command.
Wait a minute. Wait, you can't.
Total extermination. Fire, fire, fire. Maximum power. Fire, fire, fire. Weaponry malfunction. Total power failure in armament circuits.
Right, Tom Baker. One of the most iconic actors in Doctor Who ever. I'm not going to bother putting them in, like, oh, he goes before him. I'm just putting them in the sections. So, Tom Baker, like, he was the longest running actor to play the Doctor, and probably one of the most memorable. I like, he goes back to the Daleks' creation. I like the scene where he goes on about,
if someone who knew the future pointed out a child to you and told you that that child would grow up totally evil, to be a ruthless dictator who would destroy millions of lives, could you then kill that child?
And now we've got Peter Davison. His titles were very 80s, very galactic. And I think that sums up a bit. The early 80s was very, like, more sci-fi than the 60s. Celery, cricket. I like his TARDIS. And overall, like, he just seems a very nice Doctor to be around. So he's going in Amazing. Resurrection of the Daleks, I think. The scene where, my earliest memory, the scene where the Dalek sort of materializes and you just hear him go, and you just see them all run away.
Look!
What is it?
A Dalek.
Take cover!
Exterminate! 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 Exterminate!
And then they shove the Dalek out of a window.
Warning, emergency!
The Sixth Doctor. I mean, he is good. I do like him. Colin Baker is very nice. There was a joke. I meet him at the Comic Cons, and there was a joke when we first met, and he went, "It's Harry Potter." One of the most controversial bits was, there's actually two controversial bits. His first episode, he chokes Perry.
Well, we all know the fate of alien spies.
Didn't really like that much. And then the second one was where there were two people in an acid bath. He doesn't even try to save them. And then he has a really, like, cheesy James Bond moment where he goes,
"You forgive me if I don't join you."
Overall, it's hard to put them in, like, just five. I'm going to put him in, it's in between these two. In terms of, like, Doctor, like, character, I'd probably go meh. But in terms of the actor, it's amazing. Like, people have said that about Jodie Whittaker's era. She was good, but it was the writing that let her down. Sylvester McCoy. I like Sylvester McCoy. He's funny. Overall, like, I just think he's funny. He has this sort of, like, mentor about him. It's probably because I watch him with Ace. But he had this sense of, like, a teacher about him. But a reckless one.
You're not carrying any nitro-9 explosives in there.
No.
What do you make of that van?
Aim for the eyepiece! Ace, give me some of that nitro-9 that you're not carrying. Quickly. And another.
This one just can.
I should hope so, too. And how long the fuse?
10 seconds.
That's long enough.
My darling!
Me, the Doctor. What's the matter? Don't you recognize your mortal enemy?
especially in Remembrance of the Daleks, he has this sense of, like, he's... And also, I just love his run. I love his run. It's funny. And actually, Remembrance of the Daleks was the first one I actually ever remember watching. I'm not sure if it was... Because I remember the earliest memory that I can have of Doctor Who is Eccleston's Dalek. But I can remember watching the Imperial Dalek in the 80s go up the stairs for the first time.
Stay where you are! Do not move!
The stairs!
But yeah, amazing. Paul McGann, Eighth Time War. Sorry, let me redo that. Eighth Doctor, The Time War. The TV movie, contrary to popular opinion, I liked the TV movie. I just feel like there were some bits that definitely screamed America films at me. The scene where Grace runs down in like this like big theater dress. That bit honestly just rings, like, screams America for me. And also probably the bit with the gang will say violence in terms of this getting taken down. We'll say violence. The Doctor getting shot down in a gang war. And then having to go through the surgery, ultimately dying because of the surgery. It just seemed a bit not Doctor Who-like for me, shall we say. But I actually like the Eighth Doctor. So we are going to put him in amazing. John Hurt, War Doctor, 2013. He was only the Doctor in the Day of the Doctor, in the 50th anniversary era. And... He summed up the Doctor in the Time War quite nicely. So it's like this man who has seen conflict happen right in front of him, and it changed him. He did not want the title of the Doctor anymore.
Go and be the Doctor that I could never be. Make it worthwhile.
I want to put him in amazing, but I want to put him here because I don't want Colin Baker by himself. But overall... War Doctor, amazing. I'm just doing it amazing. And then we've got Eccleston. Christopher Eccleston, Ninth Doctor. The first one on our screens in 2005 of New Who. I liked the leather jacket. And I also, I liked the sort of like, the I'm just going to save a bit of time quickly. Here I was trying to say that he was more of a, let's just go on with things and only make a joke when necessary, Doctor. The scene that really sold that he was the Doctor for me is in the first Slovene episode. He sort of comes out of a cupboard that the TARDIS came in. And he's surrounded by the military. He hears someone scream and then he just leads them down the corridor. That's the bit that, for me, that's the bit that really seemed like this is a good... character.
Defense Pattern Delta, come on!
Move!
Honestly, he's going iconic, because I really like him. And now we've got David Tennant. Just no doubt about it. There's really too much to go on for David Tennant. I'm already 20 minutes into filming this. So, I don't really know why I like the scene that I do so much, but for me it is the scene in Blink where the TARDIS takes off from the basement surrounded by angels and they think they're about to die because it's left them behind, and who was the one person they shout for on the verge of death? The Doctor. For me it just seems like he has become a character that people would turn to in their final moments.
Ah! Ah!
Matt Smith is always a win. Like, in Matt Smith, My Doctor, fashion sense was meh, but bow ties are cool. The scene, I remember, the earliest memory I have of watching Matt Smith is his final episode, the time of the Doctor. I remember I was sitting in the corner of the sofa, and when Peter Capaldi came on screen, I just said, "But you're the Doctor, you should know how to fly this thing." I was nearly six, don't judge me.
We all change. When you think about it, we are all different people all through our lives. And that's okay, that's good, you've got to keep moving so long as you remember all the people that you used to be. I will not forget one line of this. Not one day, I swear. I will always remember when the Doctor was me.
Raggedy Man. Good night.
But anyway, and then Peter Capaldi. Everyone says Peter Capaldi is a good sort of character of the Doctor. That he is one of the best, and I do agree with that. Because he sort of has, he knows what he's doing. He's got the sass and the sarcasm.
Look, is she all right? Will you bring her over?
I can't bring her over. I'm a Time Lord, not a childminder.
You've got a spaceship. Well, we've got our Oyster cards.
And I've got a global rapid afforestation crisis to deal with.
Oh, he's a bright one. Hang on to him.
He knows what he's doing. He's got the sass and the sarcasm. But he also knows when to make the joke. Especially in the Nardole era, with Bill and Nardole.
Oh, look, Bill, it's Nardole. What a lovely surprise. I thought I sent you to Birmingham for a packet of crisps.
Yeah, I saw through your cunning ruse.
Yes, well, if you will go thinking for yourself, what do you want?
I was given strict instructions to keep you at the university.
Who by?
You!
Well, you're not doing a very good job, are you? I'll overlook it this once.
Do you know what this is?
If it's not crisps, you're sacked.
Fluid link K57. Removed it from the TARDIS the other night after your lecture.
That is very untrusting.
You took an oath, sir. The vault cannot be unguarded.
Listen to Mr. Borin.
I'm acting under your orders.
See how reliable I am?
What's the fluid link?
No idea. But the TARDIS can't go anywhere without it.
Who told you that?
You did.
Exactly.
What?
Teach you to trust me?
No.
I'm docking your pay for this.
I really like the bit. The bit that I really like is what is in the... Oh, God, what's it called? Oh, it's like it's Dark Water, Death in Heaven. I really like the bit where he falls out of the plane and then he does a Mission Impossible-style, like, skydive towards the TARDIS. I really love that bit. So for that reason, he's going in amazing. Now we've got Jodie Whittaker. I do like Jodie Whittaker, but again, it's the fact of like the writing of like her character arc and the storyline and the timeless child. I mean, overall, good Doctor, but again, it's the writing that does it for me. Although I do like the Rosa Parks episode. I do like that.
1955? Elvis, could we see Elvis?
I think he's in New York this week. I could give him a call.
You haven't got Elvis's phone number.
Don't ever tell anyone I lent him a mobile phone. Is anyone excited? Because I'm really excited.
You won't be if it's a bomb.
Don't kill the vibe, Graham.
The episode that I watch a lot of her is the... I'm going on iPlayer right now because I can't... Village of Angels, that's it. The Village of the Angels. I just really like it. I just like the action of the Doctor being cornered in the house with all the angels. I like that bit. And I like Kevin McNally being in it as well.
It was a little alarming.
Not as alarming as the readings that have set my sonic off.
Who are you?
You can call me the Doctor.
The Institute of Psychic Investigation?
Looks like it. Interesting.
How did you get in here?
Your door was open.
It most certainly was not.
Well, it was once I opened it, but let's not get bogged down in the order of things. Did I not tell you to stay downstairs?
This is my house. Vandalism! If I get my hands on the person who threw this...
Jericho, wait!
How did they get here?
Back away, slowly, into the house. Keep your eyes on them. Don't look away. And don't blink.
What are you talking about?
Why are they here? Lock everything!
And then the fugitive doctor, Jo Martin. She is good. She is good. I do like Jo Martin. I do like her. But it's the fact that... Another version of the Doctor that didn't really make sense, and especially since it was kind of introduced in the Timeless Child arc, it's like, although the TARDIS was good, I did like her TARDIS. And before we move on to the next one, one thing I'm just going to say, the current Doctors, they're not on here yet, but if I could put the 14th Doctor somewhere, I would probably put him... I put him with the majority, actually, because I feel like Doctor Who was trying to get a bit of the hype back, but they've tied it in to the storyline quite successfully, because I have this feeling that it's trying to, like, bridge the gap between, like, going towards Shutigatwa, and, like, Shutigatwa, I saw his look for the Doctor with the checkered jacket and the orange shirt and the... I'm just going to be honest, That's the first time in a while that I haven't even seen the Doctor, like, be on TV yet, and I already know that he's going to be good. Like, I heard his voice, and I saw the look that he was going for, it's one of those things where I just loved the character design from the beginning, and I feel like now with Russell D. Davis and, like, the Disney Plus budget of something like 100 million or something, we're going to be in for a... good couple seasons of Doctor Who. If he lives up to the hype that he's caused, he could very well go into iconic status. But that's the Doctor's done. We're moving on to the TARDIS. Time and relative dimension in space. Bigger on the inside than it is on the outside. Oh, look at that. It's already in chronological order for me. I'm gonna start off with the first Doctor's TARDIS. I'm gonna be honest. I like it a lot. Because it's 1963. There were actual police boxes about. 1963 in London. There were a bunch of police phone boxes about. In 69, they're all gone. Except some that are declared like National Heritage or something, like Earl's Court police box. But yeah, one of the reasons that I do like it is because it is... what a police box looked like back then. So yeah, that's the first and second Doctor's one, I think. And now the second and third Doctor's one. It got that hint of, like, TARDIS blue. And again, I probably have to put in, I like it a lot. Because it was the first TARDIS in colour. Like, it was in black and white, so we didn't really get a hint of, like, we didn't get a hint of what it actually looked like in real life. It was just black and white. I liked it. I actually like it. And then we've got the fourth Doctor. I like the shape. I think it looks very... police boxy, if you know what I mean. Like, this one, like, it's a bit... I like it, it's good, but this one just sort of looks more like it fits... like, it blends in a bit more. I don't really know why. Again, like, I like it. Yeah, I put it in, I like it a lot. And now I move on to basically the entire 80s TARDIS. If you want my opinion, it's too blue. Like, it's too light. It looks out of place. Because, like, you know, it's the 80s. There aren't many police boxes about. So it sort of sticks out for me. So it's good. But that's all. Again with, like, the 8th Doctor's one. Like, they've just sort of redone the blue. They did give it more TARDIS blue. I'm going to give America that. But there's not really much changed about it, really. And then we got 9 and 10. I do like the first TARDIS of Classic Who. I think it's very iconic. Because it sort of... It looks like the old police box. But then it also adds the hint of, like, modern. It looks like a modern police box, if you know what I mean. So, I do like it a lot. And then we got Matt Smith's one. I like the fact that the little white door handle lights up and it glows in the dark. It's Matt Smith's TARDIS. Like, I'm very biased towards Matt Smith. And then we got Capaldi's one. Lightened the blue a bit, but I don't think it made that much of a difference. The one thing that they definitely did change is the windows. I do like it a lot. The only difference for me is the windows. And then we got the current TARDIS. In terms of current TARDIS, I don't... The only problem I had with it, it wasn't TARDIS blue. But now I'm sort of... The TARDIS for me is something that you need to get used to. Because I remember when I first saw the TARDIS, I went, they got rid of the TARDIS blue. But now, like, I'm used to it. I like it now. And it's like, it's just something that I have to get used to. The TARDIS exterior is just one of the changes that we have to get used to. But I like the black pull to open bit. I like that. I like the black bit. And my grandma actually told me this. The light on the TARDIS, it's blue. And that was actually quite historically accurate, apparently. Because the police box lights, they were blue. Because blue meant police back in the day. So thanks to my grandma for that one. But again, like, I like it. I like it a lot. And one thing that I did like about Jodie's TARDIS, or the current TARDIS, is the At 60 musical celebration. It changed the middle bottom window texture, the bottom middle windows. And I just felt like that was a change that could have actually fit the TARDIS a bit. Because we've had the two windows change, but we never had the one. It looks good. And anyway, we've seen the TARDIS exteriors. Let's move on to the interiors. The bigger on the inside with dimensional engineering. Seems to change with every Doctor's console. Now, there have been, like, the Hellbent interior and the First Doctor's interior, they do look nearly identical in a way. So wherever I put the First Doctor, I'm just going to put Hellbent interior. First Doctor. It was the first TARDIS interior that we've ever got. And I like the consoles with all the, like, flicky buttons. Like, it seems very technical, like, in the way that a TARDIS should be. So I'm probably going to put it in decent, because it was working on a budget, but it managed to make a TARDIS with budget look really good. And with Hellbent, they just sort of gave it that bit of, like, modern sense to it. And we've got Patrick Troughton's one. Patrick Troughton's basically sort of stayed the same. We got a better look at the TARDIS a bit, but again, it's a decent interior. I do like it. And then we got the Third Doctor's one. First one in colour. It seemed a bit plain. Actually, no. I could just remember Patrick Troughton going,
"Oh, I can see you've been doing the TARDIS up a bit. I don't like it."
Oh my word.
And I'm sort of with him on that. Like, it just sort of took all of the, like, lived-in feel to it. It just sort of seemed more like a temporary use thing. And then we got the Fourth Doctor's one. I'm going to be honest, I liked the console. I liked the console. It seemed very, like, something you can, like, I liked the consoles. So I would probably put it in decent again. The Roundels in that as well, like, they had a sense of like life to it. Like, there is something in with, like, cased within, like the TARDIS is in the surroundings. And then the secondary control room, I'm gonna be 100% honest, I don't like it that much. I like the fact that they tried to give it a sense of like a secondary or emergency control room, but the one thing I feel like Tom Baker's here is they sort of, I don't know how to say it, they sort of like, I'm just gonna say, exaggerated the TARDIS a bit. Because I feel like in the way that they did it with Matt Smith, they sort of created that, like, mystical, strange, that word. But, like, they just straight up showed us some of it. I do like the sense that they showed us how the TARDIS corridors are, and that, and the room with all the vines and the cloister bell and things. But that's the one thing that I don't really like about the TARDIS in the 80s. And then move on to Peter Davison's one, and Colin Baker, and a bit of McCoy. I do like it. Console-wise, it's fantastic. They sort of kept the interior a bit Tom Baker, but they just did the console up in a way that seemed a lot more TARDIS-y, in a way. I just like a bunch of buttons that I can press. And then we got the TV movie one. For me, the TV movie interior is the one that has the most lived-in kind of feel. I remember watching it for the first time when I saw that Sylvester McCoy just sitting down eating some jelly babies. I feel like it's a TARDIS meant for retirement. I feel like I'm going to get a lot of backlash for that, but this is my opinion. You are welcome to your own opinion. Like, the console, like, it's not the console that I would like to use, but I feel like it's one of the more obvious ones, like, ooh, that's there, that's there, that's there. And the top, the fact that it's like, it shows space, I like that bit as well. So, I'd probably put it in decent. And then we've got the War Doctors one. It definitely had this sort of like, just like, I'm dropping all of the decoration, just a main TARDIS console. But then it was very messy because of the Time War. And it definitely resembled 10th and 9 and 10's Golden Interior. But I feel like for a TARDIS to look decent, you need to keep it very technical and spacey-wacy, but you also need to keep it very decorated. And one of the reasons, honestly, I don't like it is because it lacked that decoration. But yeah. And then we've got 9 and 10's one, the first one in New Who. And I did like it, but like, I liked the walls and the round things and the pillars and the console. It just seemed like this console that was like just sort of put together and then tidied when 10th came along. And I like it. I do like it a lot. No, actually no, I'm putting it in fantastic. And then we got Matt Smith's. I've already told you I love Matt Smith's. It's going in fantastic. But Matt Smith's, the one thing that, in my opinion, summed up why I like Matt Smith, it was strange and mysterious and magical, but it also created this feeling of, like, you were safe. And overall, I just like Matt Smith's thing. Like, I liked the names he gave things, like the friction contrafibrillator or something, and the wibbly lever. I like the way he described it as well. And then we got Capaldi's one, and also Matt Smith's second one. And people describe that as being one of the best TARDIS setups, and I do agree. I like the console because it's a good mix of both. There's a lot of buttons that you can push, but then there's stuff that stands out with Matt Smith's one. Like, I like the way, like, the lights reacted to when you pulled it, but that the one with Capaldi just seemed more spacey. So for that reason, Capaldi's one is fantastic. I do like it. And then there's Jodie Whittaker's one. I liked the colours of it. The flux, not so much. I liked it when it was cleaner. But I liked the custard cream dispenser. So for that reason, it's going in decent. And now, mine. That section, out of all of these, it's the one that I would use the most. And I'm gonna give it to Peter Capaldi, actually. As much as I do like Matt Smith's, I'm gonna give it to Peter Capaldi's and Matt Smith's second one. Peter Capaldi gave it a very decorated feeling, but the bit that I don't like that much is the fact he changed the Time Rotor colours. I liked it when they were green. And actually, before I forget, let's talk about the interior for the new era, 14th and Shooty Gatwa era. I've seen the leaked, like, blurred images of it, and I like it. I actually love it. Because I saw the white, walls in this really strange, like, console, and it just sort of, I actually fell in love with it. I loved it. And again, if it does live up to the hype, it would become the new one that would replace Capaldi's. But anyway, now let's move on to the Doctor's next trusted thing, sonic screwdrivers. Now, the sonic screwdrivers. William Hartnell did not have one. It was Patrick Troughton that first used one. And looking at the ranks that I've got on here, we're going to have a very cool one. The good mix is when it's a good mix of sonic and a screwdriver. And I'm going to be completely honest, I'm probably going to end up putting that one in the good mix. The too technical is when it doesn't look like a screwdriver. So Patrick Troughton's one, it is the first, I'm going to give it that, but it's not a sonic screwdriver. I'm putting it in meh. I would put it in not a screwdriver, but the fact that it was the first concept, it was the first, it's going up one. And then we move on to Pertwee's Baker, Davison, Baker, and McCoy, and a bit McGann. But again, like, all three of them, they're a good mix. And I'm grouping them together because only one thing changes, basically, the colours of the top bit and that round bit. It's a good mix. I do like it a lot. I mean, if we're being completely honest, I'm going to put that in very cool. And then we move on to... Oh, God. Pretty sure that's comic 8 screwdriver. Looking at it, it looks meh. But if there's one thing I do like on it, it's the crystal. Like, it looks very steampunk in a way. And then we got the War Doctor's one. Again, like, it's lacking that top bit, and that's what lets it down for me. Other than that, it just looks a bit meh. And then we've got 9 and 10, and the reason you can tell this is 9 is because his tube bit, as we're going to call it, was more blue. And then when it got into 10, it got a bit plain. But again, it's a good mix. It looks like a tool that you would find in... It looks casual, in a way. It looks casual, and I like it. And then we got Rivers 1. Like, again, like, nothing really changes in them except the handle, and I like that handle a bit more, actually. We're going to go very cool for that. And then Matt Smith's one. When it's in the not extended form, I like it. And when it's in the extended one, it looks technical. Again, like, it is a good mix. It is a good mix of both sonic and screwdriver. And it also fits the like, copper aesthetic sense of the TARDIS and the 11th Doctor. And then we got Capaldi's one. I'm going to be honest, it looks way too technical. Capaldi used Matt Smith's screwdriver for, I think, the first two series. When that one came out, I liked it, but it didn't look like a screwdriver, to be honest. It looked very technical. And then we've got Jodie Whittaker's one. Like, I do like it. I liked the crystal effect, the crystal it had on the top. I liked the yellow and the sounds it made, but, like, we're putting it in meh. Like, I do like it. I would probably use it if I was in my own Doctor cosplay, but it's just not the best for me. And then the current one. Wait. Oh, it's back there. Right, I will be back. I've got it in my display. I just need to. I get it. Right, come on, out you come. Hi, Ace. So, my mum got this a couple months ago without telling me. And it is the online exclusive version of the Sonic Screwdriver. It's not coming out of its box. I'm waiting till I get the toy yet, because I haven't got it yet. But just looking at it, I do like it a lot. I do like it a lot. It looks like a screwdriver to me. I'm gonna go into the city in a couple of days' time and actually get this. Because I so just wanna like get it out of its box and look at it and like just muck about a bit. But as far as we're concerned, we're not touching this one. But yeah, like the current screwdriver, I do like it. And the fact that Shurigawa was gonna get his own apparently, like, and now we're gonna respect the visual effects and the music of Doctor Who. And rank the titles and music. Doctor Who titles. They accompany every single Doctor Who episode, mostly with a middle eight. Anyway, the first. It's going in iconic purely because it was the first. And then the second one. I know it's Patrick Troughton's, and they definitely did add more of the effects to it, but when it finishes and you just get that bit at the top, when I look at it, it just makes me dizzy. So, it's good, but the bit about making me dizzy and the writing as well, I would have preferred it if they kept the old writing. And then move on to the first one in colour. Very, very 70s, very Technicolor. I like it because I think it is very 70s. Like, early 70s, I think it is. Because that's when colour, like, came to Doctor Who. And they wanted to make the most of it. And I just think it suited John Pertwee a bit. And then we move on to the first, what I call the Doctor Who Diamond intro. That's because, but that is what it is. That's not a diamond, but that's a triangle. But again, like, it is iconic. I know that Tom Baker really brought it to life, but I liked the colours of John Pertwee's second one. It's a mix of both. I like the beginning bit with the TARDIS for Tom Baker's one, but then I also like the colours, like, going further away, if you know what I mean. But Tom Baker's one, like, I would have to put it in good. Tom Baker's second one, the 1980s. Tom Baker's one, the second one. It definitely, the stars and everything, they looked really 3D. And they looked computer-generated, but in a good way. So, I'd probably put it in good. And then in terms of Peter Davison's... Again, it's probably good. Colin Baker's one... They redid the text, and for the Trial of the Time Lord, they redid the music, and I think it suited Colin Baker a bit more. Okay, it's probably going in good again, because I liked the sort of, like, spinny purple bit it had, like, around it. Yeah, that bit. And then we move on to Sylvester McCoy's one. I think it's very 80s Britain, with like the heavy use of computer generated images. And the big who, I think it's very... I think it's very 80s. It's probably one of the most iconic ones for me. Basically, I just like it a lot. And then you've got the 90s TV movie one. I liked the music for it. It's very, very big, very loud, very orchestra-like. I liked how it, it seemed like a thing for a movie. And I did like it a lot. So it's going in good. And then we move on to Nine's one. There's not really much difference between 9 and 10. The only difference that I can really see is that they changed the look of Doctor Who. I started to like this one over Tennant's, and then I realised it looked a bit too plain. But it's going in good because I like the music, I like the images and the video and everything, but again it's like that Doctor Who is better than that Doctor Who. And while we're on the subject of that, we're going to put this in iconic, because that's where it serves to be. And then we move on to Matt Smith's first one. Again, I like that. I like it. Because a whole new thing was made for it. Because originally, they 9 and 10 used samples from the old ones. But a whole new one was remade for Matt Smith's one. Again, it's going in iconic because I like Matt Smith. I like the logo for it as well. I like the fact that the DW is a TARDIS and it spins around to... And then we move on to the 2013 Matt Smith one. I don't really like it that much, to be honest. I do like the time vortex that had this one a lot, though. But... it's probably mediocre. The text is more Capaldi for me. And speaking of Capaldis, I do like the visuals on it. I like the music. The one thing that let me down, though, is that it was out of sync in a lot of the episodes. And I can't really picture it in sync anymore. But it was good. And then Jodie Whittaker's one. I like it. Like, the crystal Doctor Who text. I like the fact that it goes into the O. I just like it a lot. And then, as I'm recording this, we haven't got the new titles yet. We've only got the music, which I'm going to admit, took me a while to get into. When I listened to it first time, I realised that it was a bit slow. But then I realised it's being played by a live orchestra. So, hopefully, this is actual me here. Hopefully, they speed it up for the actual show. And if the orchestra can make it sound good before you've even heard the TV one... What is the TV one going to sound like? While we're on about TV episodes and everything, we're going to move into the best ending episodes. I haven't looked at this in a while, and they've updated it with the first of the 60 specials. So that's good. So some of these... I know you can't see them all, because there's a lot of them. That one down there is Power of the Doctor, and then that's the new 60s one. And And again, we're not going to put a personal favourite up there until we've finished reviewing all of them. But some of these are storyline endings, some of these are actual Doctor endings, and... Anyway, Bad Wolf and Parting of the Ways. It sums up Doctor Who's first storyline. I think it's very iconic as the first... as the Ninth Doctor's finish. Like, it showed the true scale of... It showed what Russell T Davies can do when given the showrunner. I'm going to try and keep the explanation short, because we have pretty much have 13 seasons to go through. There's almost double the finales that are in the seasons. So, anyway, the next one is, Army of Ghosts and Doomsday. That is sad. That is sad. I'm putting it up there because it's sad. Some people don't think it's sad, but it kind of is. The Doomsday thing for me is what makes it sad. Whenever I hear Doomsday, I just immediately go sort of like... But yeah, it's a good send-off for Rose Tyler. And the sad one. Basically, it's iconic because it's sad. The Master. I like the Master. But I like the fact that... I like the fact that he had control of everything. I like the fact that, like, the Doctor was sort of stuck there without his TARDIS, and... The bit that sort of lets it... No, there is nothing that lets it down for me, because it's good, it's epic. And then we got the time the Daleks took the Earth and flew away. I think it's epic because of the music when they bring the Earth back home. It's also sad for Donna Noble, and... In terms of the sixth episode, like, I wonder what's going to happen with Donna, because if she remembers the Doctor, she will die, her mind will burn, and she will die. So, how's he going to get around that? End of Time. 10th Doctor's send-off. I like it, because it's David Tennant's send-off. And also, Bernard Cribbins, Wilfred Mott, like, I like him, my mum likes him, my grandpa likes him. And then we've got Matt Smith's first one, the Pandorica opens and the Big Bang. It's just iconic for me. Like, I like it a lot. I love it. And then we've got The Good Man Goes to War. I think it's a big plot twist on the identity of River Song. Epic. Because I like how the Doctor gathers an army. Oh, God, what's that called? Wedding. The Wedding of River Song, I think. Oh, yeah. No, yep, it's epic. And then we've got Angels Take Manhattan. The last of Series 7 Part 1. It is very sad. Amy Pond and Rory, they do get a happy life together though, but the Doctor just couldn't see them again because of they were stuck in a point where the Doctor couldn't go. It is very epic, in a way. And then we've got The Name of the Doctor. I'm going to be honest, I don't like the fact that the Doctor went to his grave. When you're a time traveler, there is one place that you must never go. That's exactly what he said. I'm just gonna be honest, it's okay. I'm going by the rules here. If you're a time traveler, don't go see your grave. And then we got the Day of the Doctor. It's the 50th anniversary special. Like, putting it anywhere apart from iconic is just shameful. Time of the Doctor, it's epic. And then we got, oh yeah, this is one where he falls out the TARDIS. Danny becoming a sideman, that was sad, I remember that, that was sad. The Master, Missy, oh no, it's epic because Missy is the Master.
Hey Missy, you're so fine, you blow my mind, hey Missy. Hey.
And then we got the one where he's trapped in the confession dial. The one thing I don't like about it is that, like, for that one, he just sort of had this complex where after he lost Clara, he just wanted revenge. And I get that, but I feel like that's not in character of the Doctor. So, for that sake, it's okay. And then we got the Missy Master Doctor Bill Cyberman one. I'd probably say it's epic. Because I like how the Doctor tries to hide his regeneration because he doesn't want Bill to worry. And he's like got that sort of like I am going to keep you safe even though I am already mid-dying. And then twice upon a time, Dave Bradley, a Villa fan, met the guy. I like it. And now we move on to resolutions. It's the one with the Daleks. We're going to move on to the Daleks in a bit. But I did like... It's going in epic for me. Because I liked the Dalek design. Ascension of the Cybermen. This is when the writing was not good for Jodie Whittaker. So for that reason, it's not going in memorable. And the Timeless Children, just no. Although I did like the scene where she sort of floods the Matrix with information. I did like that bit.
Have a blast of this, Matrix.
And then we got the Flux ending. It's okay.
Nothing is forever. No regeneration. No life. Beware of the forces that mass against you. And their master.
And then Power of the Doctor. Like, it's epic for me. I like it a lot. Tegan, Ace, previous Doctors... I liked it a lot, and then I remember this very clearly. When David Tennant came on, I literally screamed. I can't really have an opinion on them because I haven't seen them yet. We haven't seen them yet. I'm gonna be 100% honest. Power of the Doctor. Because it's the BBC's 100th anniversary, and it was celebrating the show. And also, I like the Master's little dance. But anyway, let's move on to the Daleks. Exterminate. The Great Space Dustbin. Now, looking at the first Dalek, they were good. Yeah, no, I'm going to keep them as good. Because again, it's the budget. They worked with the budget very well. They did make something that was a bit spooky. So, yeah. And then we've got the ones from the Invasion of Earth. Again, they look pretty much the same. The only thing that changed was that they had a round disc on their back and the sort of black bit of the bomb was sort of heightened a bit. And then we've got the ones from the Chase. Oh, the one with the flamethrower. But in terms of all the black and white classic ones, they're all the same. Oh, God. Except the Emperor. The Emperor looked good. Oh, that's the Day of the Daleks. Oh, God, they were good, but the thing that brings it down for me was their voices.
It sounded like they were in a fan. It sounded like a voice talking in a fan.
All enemies of the Daleks must be destroyed.
And then these ones, I'm gonna be honest, I really liked the Death to the Dalek ones. I don't know why, but they looked like the best version of the 60s, 70s Daleks for me. And also, some of their voices were good.
The power failure is temporary. Superior Dalek technology will overcome interference shortly.
Weapon evidently designed to destroy humanoid tissue. We will continue. Wait.
And then again, the Daleks for Tom Baker's. And, for Tom Baker and Peter Davison's era. They were good, because storyline-wise, they were the first Daleks. Travel machines, I think they were called.
A Dalek.
What? Dalek. Very primitive, but undeniably a Dalek.
You're mistaken. It's a Mark III travel machine.
You say so.
They looked good. They looked, sinister. And, yeah, we're not going to talk about that one because that one has a name which I cannot say in the video. And then we've got the one from the, oh God, that's the 20th anniversary special, I think, the Five Doctors. It looked like that one, And the bits on the head change, and I liked it. I do like it.
Oh, here we go. Genesis of the Daleks.
Yeah, they, in my opinion, they're pretty much the same. So, yeah.
And then we've got, oh, yeah. Yeah. Baker McCoy Daleks. But the Baker McCoy Daleks. I'm going to be honest, like, these Bakers were acceptable. Like, it's the voice for Colin Baker that let me down.
Shut the fool up!
It is the Doctor! You will be exterminated! You will take me to Davros! Now!
Of course!
What? Like, it's probably one of the worst voices for the Dalek. And then they got an upgrade for Remembrance of the Daleks, and they looked really gold, and like the fact that they looked really like clean and like white and gold on Earth, or like they looked alien. So for that reason, I told you it's in my top three in my Minecraft mod view. It's one of the best. It's one of the supreme. And the Renegade Daleks, they were good. I liked the Supreme Renegade Dalek. And then we've got one of the iconic Daleks of New Who. We've got the Bronze, Time War, Copper Daleks. Again, it's probably the Supreme ones because it's iconic. And then this is it for me. Like, the Paradigm Daleks, I loved because the fact that they were just so big and like tall, and the fact that they had different colours, for me it was easy to remember. And I liked it more when the colours got darker and the eyes sort of looked more menacing.
Oh. What do the Daleks do when they're too scared?
The Predator of the Daleks will be deployed.
So for that reason, the first version of Paradigms is amazing, and the taller, darker red one is very supreme. And then these ones. I talked about these. They had a lot of potential. I think they had a lot of very good potential here. Because again, like, they looked futuristic. Because they were meant to be police drones, and then Daleks took over them, and like, they just looked good. Like, I just think they could have been amazing. There are no great space dustbins today. And now here's one that I've just looked at and I'm actually stressing about. Companions. My TARDIS team. Three people I would have on my TARDIS trips. And we're going to put the TARDIS up real quick because you can't have the TARDIS team without a TARDIS. Rose Tyler. Yes. Actually, no, very cool. Right, I like Rose Tyler a lot because a lot of experience with the Doctor. And then we got Jack. I'm going to try and limit this. We're going to try and not waste too much time. Jack, he time agent, he can't die. We're going to assign my TARDIS team after we've done all these, by the way. And we've got Mickey. Actually, no, I like Mickey. Mickey's funny. And we've got Jackie. Jackie Tyler is also very funny. Oh, Adam. I've got this little side character section is because for ones that only appear in a couple episodes. And we've got Sarah Jane Smith and K-9. We're kind of Sarah Jane Smith about K-9. Sarah Jane Smith, she was a classic companion. Came back and managed to get her own TV series. We've got Martha Jones. We like Martha Jones. Donna Noble. Donna Noble was very funny. I'm going to do very big explanations when I get to my TARDIS team. Wilf. We love Wilf. Amy Pond. I met Amy Pond recently. I met Karen Gillan recently. And we've got Rory. We love Rory. And River. I'm meeting River in a couple of days. When I'm filming this, I'm meeting River in a couple of days. Brian Pond. We like Brian Pond. Clara. I'm also meeting Clara. Oh, God. I googled this a couple of days ago. Jenny Vastrin Strax, what are they called? the Paternoster Gang. But anyway, the Paternoster Gang, they are very experienced, so they're all going in yes. Strax is funny, Avastra is a leader, and Jenny is very good with swords. And we've got Bill, we love Bill. Nardole, we love Nardole. Nardole is funny. Hey, Missy, you're so fine, you blow my mind. Hey, Missy. We've got Graham, we love Graham. Bradley Walsh, we love Bradley Walsh. We love Bradley Walsh. Bradley Walsh is funny, because he makes a lot of references. Ryan, and Yaz. That was very short. But now, it's time for the very long explanation. We need to choose my TARDIS team. I can't do three. No, I'm upping it to five because I like having a gang. So, starting off my TARDIS team, we are going to have... I want people with, like, experience. Forget all the storyline. We're going on experience and who I want. So, we are probably going to start off with Jack and K-9. Jack, because he's very funny and knows his way around time travel and stuff. And K-9, because I just love K-9. I want a little pet dog that I can take with me. And then, okay, so I've got three left. I think I would bring along Bradley Walsh for the laughs, Rory, and Nardole. That's my TARDIS team. The boys and a K-9. Whew! I just want to say I have been going for well over an hour and a half filming this, so... congratulations to those of you that have actually sat through and watched this however long I decide to make it. So, I think that is all. No, it's not! Ruby Sunday. Based on the stuff we've seen, I think, because we haven't seen it yet, but I do like Minnie Gibson, we're going to put Minnie Gibson in yes. Going to put Minnie Gibson in yes. So, and there you have it. Congratulations to those of you that have actually managed to stick through about an hour and 10 minutes of me rambling on about Doctor Who. Remember, this is all just my opinion. You're welcome to your opinion. So, is your opinion different to mine, or do we share some reviews on Doctor Who? Let me know in the comments. Anyway, thanks for watching. Like, share, appreciation, like, subscribing, tapping the bell. See you then, miss another video by yours truly, Teddy Sparkles. Happy birthday, Doctor Who, 60 years on. And I've just thought there's no better way to end this big review than with the newest rendition of Murray Gold's theme tune for Doctor Who, mixed with about a minute's montage of my editing. I hope you enjoy it. Peace out. Goodbye.